Thank you for the introduction. Yes, I'm Jan van den Brandt. I want to talk about sensitive distance oracles, and this is joint work with Tachapan Saranurak. And the main message I want to convey here in this talk is that if you work on graph algorithms or data structures, then you should care about symbolic computation. So maybe once in a while visit this ESAC conference. Okay, so first, what are failure-sensitive oracles? Let me define this model. So this is a data structure problem where we have three phases. First, we are given some graph, and the data structure is allowed to preprocess it. So here is, all right. So at the top, we see a graph. We are allowed to preprocess it, and if you want a less abstract example, you can think of the road network down below. And after this preprocessing, what happens next is that maybe some of the edges are going to be removed. You can think of it as the traffic conditions change. Maybe some roads are blocked, maybe there's a traffic jam. And then in the last phase, someone is going to ask for the distance between two nodes, and that you can interpret as, well, what's the shortest path given the current traffic conditions? All right, so this is sensitive distance oracles, and typically we try to minimize the preprocessing and the updating query time while also minimizing memory. And there are some obvious trivial solutions. So one thing we could do is whenever someone asks for the distance, we just run Dijkstra, right? And in worst case, on a dense graph, that would need something like n square time. So what we want is an algorithm where the update and query complexity is less than n square. Another trivial way would be, well, if we know there are going to be f edges that are going to be deleted, just look at all the possible subgraphs and just compute all pair distances at the start and then just return the pre-computed distance, which obviously has exponential in F pre-processing and memory. Now these things are what we want to beat. Some results, there is a line of work where we consider just one deletion, and the final result is that we need roughly NQ pre-processing on a dense graph by only needing N square memory and polylog update and query time. And if we want to have less than cubic preprocessing, then there is a nice result by Kandoni and Wojcielewska-Williams where they show that assuming the weights on your graphs are some small integers, then you can do less than n cubed preprocessing while also getting less than linear query time. And in many of these papers, people have asked, well, what about more than one deletion? What if there are two deletions or more? And Duan and Petty have analyzed this and have shown that, okay, after some polynomial preprocessing, they still only need roughly n square memory and only polylog query time to return the new distance. And well, if we consider three or more deletions, then there's actually just one single paper on that, one single result by Weimann and Juster. They have shown that, okay, if we have up to roughly log n deletions, then we need roughly, it's too far away. Can you see this? Yes, good. They need n to the omega plus mu preprocessing time. Here omega is the matrix exponent, so that's the complexity for multiplying two n by n matrices. Currently that's roughly 2.38. And they also have this trade-off parameter mu, so they allow for faster update and query time at the cost of a bit more preprocessing. And this result has kind of a downside if we consider large deletions, right? Let's say f, the number of deletions, is large, some large constant, let's say 100 or 1,000. Then what happens is that this update and query complexity becomes very large, right? Because we divide this mu by f, so that becomes very close to something like n square. In that case, we might as well just run Dijkstra. So the key points here of this history overview are that handling multiple deletions was asked for multiple times. Many people are interested in this. There's only a single result for handling three or more deletions, and yet there is a strict upper bound. Like, there's no result for handling more than roughly log n deletions, and also the current best bound is almost n square whenever we have many deletions, so whenever f is large. And this kind of raises the question, maybe there is a general upper limit on f, right? Could it be that maybe this problem is just impossible for large f? Now we can answer no. Actually, any number of deletions is possible. And yeah, let's compare our result to the previous best. And for simplicity, assume that W, so the weight of the largest edge, like the largest edge weight, is going to be some constant. In that case, we managed to improve really in, we managed to improve the previous result in pretty much every category. So on one hand, the number of deletions or edge changes, we no longer have any upper limit. Right? Any number of deletions is fine. Also, we can for the first time handle insertions, which is nice because now that allows for also just increasing an edge weight instead of completely deleting it, because we can just delete the edge and reinsert it with a larger weight. When we look at the preprocessing, we also have an improvement because assuming that omega is more than 2, our preprocessing is just better than the previous one, right? The memory, assuming the weights are constant, is at least not worse. And likewise, now the update and query complexity, the nice property that we have here is that we scale only in like this polynomial of f, the number of deletions. So it doesn't matter how large a constant f is, we will always have this roughly n square minus mu query complexity compared to this previous one that for large deletions is almost n square. All right. The only kind of downside is that, well, our memory and update complexity scales in the largest weight. So if you have large weights, it's not all that useful. Okay. So now I want to talk about how we get this result. How does this data structure work? And the main idea is that we reduce this to an algebraic problem. So we first have our initial graph problem, right? We preprocess some graph G, then we change some edges, and then we want to have the distance. And Sankowski has shown that actually this is equivalent to the following algebraic problem, where we are first given some matrix M, and here this Fx means that the entries of this matrix are actually polynomials. So the matrix could look something like this, right? We don't have numbers in our entries, we now have polynomials. And then what happens in the second phase is instead of changing edges, we are now going to change some entries of this matrix. And in the last phase, we want to compute one entry of the adjoint. If you don't know what the adjoint is, then you can just think of the inverse of this matrix, because the adjoint is really just the inverse scaled by the determinant, assuming the matrix is invertible. All right. So how can we solve this? There is a formula called the Sherman-Morrison-Woodbury identity. Let's go through this term. What does it mean? So here we have our initial matrix M. And then we're going to subtract this term here, this P, E, I, E, J. E, I, E, J is just a matrix that is zero everywhere except for entry I, J. So what we're actually doing here is we just subtract the polynomial P from entry I, J of this matrix M. And now that corresponds to right changing some entry of M. And this is exactly what we're doing here. We change some entry of M. And now we want to know what is some new entry, what is the entry of the adjoint. For simplicity, let's just assume we are looking at the inverse. So we are now looking at what is the inverse of this matrix, but actually just what is this specific entry UV of this inverse. And the Sherman-Morrison-Woodbury identity just tells us, well, the new entry is going to look like this term here. And if we look hard at this term, then we see that, well, actually all of these terms are just entries of the previous inverse before we changed anything. And we can actually prove an equivalent statement for the adjoint. So what happens is that we can reduce this kind of dynamic problem where we change entries to a more static problem where we just preprocess our matrix once initially. And then we just want to know what is some entry of the adjoint. And all of these cases where something is changed is just handled by this Sherman-Morrison-Woodbury identity. Okay, so now we want to solve this new adjoint oracle problem. How can we do this? Well, there is a trivial solution, right? We could just, during the preprocessing, compute the entire adjoint. And then when later someone asks for an entry of the adjoint, we just return the pre-computed result. Zhu, Laban, and Stoyohan have shown that you can compute the adjoint in roughly n cubed time. And using this trivial solution for the adjoint oracle problem and the reduction, we already get an improvement for the case that Weimann and Juster choose mu equals 1 in their trade-off. Right? We already have that we can handle any number of deletions, and we have this better scaling in the number of deletions. Right? This is always linear for any constant f. whereas this becomes roughly n squared for large f. Okay. So then, next question is there some better way than this trivial solution for the adjoint oracle? Right? Can we find some other way to solve this problem? And unfortunately, there is a conditional lower bound. You can show that, no, if you have a data structure for this problem that works on any matrix, on every matrix, doesn't matter what type of field, then it must be the trivial solution, or at least the complexity must be the same as the trivial solution. But the thing is, we don't need an algorithm, we don't need a data structure that works on every field. It's enough if it just works on polynomial matrices. So we managed to get a result for polynomial matrices where our preprocessing is less than n cubed, assuming that we choose an appropriate trade-off parameter mu, and then our query time becomes less than n squared as well. All right, so this is our new result, and just by plugging this into the reduction, we then get our failure-sensitive distance oracle. Okay, yeah, and the nice thing is that all of this doesn't use any graph theoretic results, it's just using techniques from the symbolic computation community, so that's why I want to kind of advertise this field here. Maybe you should have a look at those results. Okay, so summary is that failure-sensitive distance oracles can be reduced to adjoint oracles. This problem of adjoint oracles is impossible if it works for every field, but if we restrict ourselves to just polynomial matrices, then we get something, and this is then also going to result in our failure-sensitive distance oracle. Okay, so let's look at the last section. How does our adjoint oracle work? Okay, assume we have some matrix M as input. It's again a polynomial matrix, and the degree of all the entries, since they're polynomials, is bounded by some parameter D. Then Zhulaban and Stoyan have shown that you can compute the adjoint in roughly n cubed time. And since in the symbolic computation area, people are more interested in getting algorithms than data structures, they didn't observe that actually they did invent a data structure. So if you look at the proof, you see that actually what they create is the following. They can preprocess this matrix M in roughly n to the omega time, which is less than n cubed. And then the data structure allows for computing adjoint of M times some vector in n squared time. And this is useful because if the vector V is just some standard unit vector, then this product is just one column of the adjoint, right? And this means, well, if we get a column of the adjoint, we also get like one specific entry. So we have this kind of trivial solution where we just compute the adjoint at the start during the preprocessing. And there is this implicit result in the same paper where they show that, okay, you can actually spend less preprocessing time and then query entries of the adjoint in n squared time. And now what we did is we generalized this further. We show that you can actually trade off between these two extremes. So we now allow for a trade off between the exponent, right? This mu is basically just saying we linearly interpolate between n cubed and omega and linear time and quadratic time. Okay, so how does this work? In their work, Zhulaban and Stoyan, but also Jeannerot and Villard, they developed something that could be called a kernel-based decomposition. What this means is the following. We have, let's say here, our adjoint M, and what they show is you can write this adjoint via some long chain of matrix products, where each matrix is block diagonal and becomes sparser and sparser, but at the same time, the degree of the polynomials that we have in the entries is always going to double. And the nice property of this decomposition is that if we look at the adjoint, right, this is an n square matrix with polynomials of degree at least n. So actually, this object consists of n cubed many numbers. But this decomposition only consists of roughly n square many numbers and some polylog factors. So it's kind of a sparse representation of the adjoint. And this one can be used for computing some entry quickly. So let's say we want to compute some entry ij of our adjoint. Then this is just the same as multiplying with some standard unit vectors from both sides, right? So let's say we have our decomposition here. and we multiply with some standard unit vector. And the standard unit vector is really sparse. So this first product, we actually just need one of these diagonal entries, right? Everything else is just multiplied with all of these zero entries of the standard unit vector. Okay, so let's compute this product. But we still have a very sparse vector. Now we can show that actually we just need one of these diagonal blocks because everything else is multiplied by zero. Okay, let's compute this. Now our vector becomes slightly denser, but still we just need one diagonal block because everything else is multiplied by zero. And we can just repeat this trick over and over again. So we can formally show, thanks, that we always just need one diagonal block to compute this, which means when we multiply the standard unit vectors from both sides, we can just think of it as deleting all of this orange part, and then everything on the right-hand side is really sparse, so we can compute that quickly. Just this part on the left is kind of dense, that is kind of the bottleneck. So what we do next is we try to remove this bottleneck. What we do is we choose this trade-off parameter mu, and just say all of the matrices where the degree is less than n to the mu, let's just compute the entire product to some prefix p. So we kind of modify this decomposition a bit. And what happens now is that, well, if we multiply the standard unit vectors, all of the orange part doesn't matter, and what remains is super sparse. And we now have just one single dense matrix on the left side. But this dense matrix is multiplied with the standard unit vector, so it's just one row of this matrix, so we can compute this quickly. And then you can show that, okay, actually to compute this, we only need roughly n square minus mu time. And that's really how our data structure works. It's first we compute the decomposition, then we compute some prefix, and when we have to answer some query, we delete lots of diagonal blocks and just compute the product with standard unit vectors from both sides. And yeah, by plugging this new adjoint oracle in our reduction, we then get our failure-sensitive distance oracle. So to summarize, this sensitive distance oracle, it was a major open problem. What happens if we have more than one deletion? We show that we can answer this by reducing to adjoint oracles. Adjoint oracles in general are impossible in the sense that they only have the trivial solution unless we really analyze the underlying field. In this case, we just have matrices with polynomials, so there we can get a result. And the main message I want to convey here is that this algebraic perspective, especially this symbolic computation perspective, can give us some really powerful tools to solve these graph theoretic problems. So for example, this kernel-based decomposition, I don't know any graph theoretic equivalent that would allow to get the same result. And in that way, one of the open questions is, are there other graph applications of this kernel-based decomposition? I would be interested in seeing that. Also, our failure-sensitive distance oracle just returns the distance. It doesn't actually return the shortest path itself. So I would be interested in seeing an oracle that can actually return the path. And yeah, at last, there is this result by Grandoni and Wasilewska-Williams with subcubic preprocessing and sublinear query time, but it only works for a single deletion. Our algorithm for the query is a bit slower. It's just subquadratic, not sublinear. I'd be interested in seeing something that is sublinear in the query time, but still handling more than one deletion. All right, thank you, and let's go to the questions. For the adjoint oracle problem?
Yes,
for that one. There are problems in the sense that I think if you have two deletions and it works on weighted graphs, then there's a lower bound that assumes the APSP conjecture, that you need n square in the query time or n cube in the preprocessing time. I think that's by Wasilewska-Williams.